Horrible things, but symbolically horrible. An old steak biscuit named after a revolutionary, no less. But only the hard left could come up with that. Pleasure in biscuits is surely a bourgeois concept. So show your commitment by only eating the crap ones. And then, the Blair eyes. Oh, it's got to be custard creams. Bland little things, I'm just gonna change the world of rock the boat. A milk toast middling biscuit, the cautious choice. One might even say prudent, a nice sugar hit followed by, nothing much else. Perhaps if the Blairites had to live on custard creams for the rest of their days, they might think about taking a risk once in a bloody while. And then there's a soft leg, with their bloody obsession with electoral reform. But it's got to be ginger nuts. It helps that they also worship King. Ginger nuts would win the AV vote on Britain's favourite biscuit. Everyone's second preference coming through the middle to win. Now the unions, they should have to live on rich tea. Partly because I like the stereotype. Rich, because, well, let's face it, that's where all the money is. And tea, because that's the image, isn't it? Of a man, and it is still usually a man with a mug of tea. Well, at least it's not beer and sandwiches anymore. And also, because rich tea has been dwindling in prominence since its heyday in the 70s. The Tories, they just make everyone else's biscuits. But, in truth, let's face it, we all just fight over the chocolate hobnobs. Chair's privilege. There's got to be something good about doing this job. Unknown, unpaid, unloved, and as always, unheated. Could we try and sort out the bloody heating? It's like a nice factory in here. Right. I now call to order this special meeting of the Labour Party National Executive Committee Organisation Subcommittee known as ORGSUB. Before we start, I have one or two notices. First, I see that we've a number of observers in tonight. Welcome, comrades. For those of you that don't know me, I'm June Wright, Chair of ORGSUB. We are here today to report on the happenings of the Constituency Labour Party of Hoddingsdean and their Member of Parliament since 2005, Ms. Sally Finch. We are not judge, jury, and executioner. We are simply here to enforce and oversee the proper implementation of the rules of the Labour Party. We're led by no factional bias, nor personal preferment. And if you believe that, I must ask that you do not interfere with the important business of the committee here tonight. I know that many of you have come to be keen observers and interpreters of the Labour Party rulebook over the years. You will also have strong opinions about how these rules should be interpreted and enforced. But there will be no point of order. This is not an interactive meeting. Let me be clear. You have no authority here. No authority at all. When I state a law or rule, that rule is law within these four walls. That's what I've been elected to this committee to do, and I shall do it to the best and strongest of my ability. Elsewhere, you may have differing opinions. In here, what I say goes. Right. Well, we'll now turn to the first report into Hoddingsdean CLP and for the 2019 general election. Now, as you know, this election was called on the 24th of October, 2019. And it took place on the 12th of December that same year.
Support education workers. Stop the cuts. Support education workers. Stop the cuts. 2005 was a fucking shit year to be elected to the Labour MP. Seriously shite. The 97 and 2001 lot, they had it easy. They got to see power up close and fresh, without any compromises, without the taint of choices already made that you had nothing to do with, without fucking Iraq and everything that's done to being a Labour MP ever since. I never knew that time. That sense of opportunity. The 2010 lot, now they got to be fresh blood. They didn't have to own the choices made in government. They weren't there for expenses. They could at least pretend to be rebuilding, even if the result of that was the disaster of 2015 and the bloodletting that followed. But 2005, people look at us and think, you chose then to sign up? And they're not wrong. The last legs of a crippled Labour government, fights over Iraq and PFI, draconian responses to 9/11. And that's before we even got to expenses and the crash. I did run in 2001. Not here. I did an unwinnable to make my mark and show willing. I did my time running around North South West Tory Shire, convincing myself I was going to win. Nice place. Picturesque. The kind of place they weigh the Tory votes. There might have been a Labour vote around the mining towns once, but they've closed the mines. And most of those villages are Tory voters' second homes now. But you have to believe. There's no point if you don't believe. You can't slog your guts out the way the voters deserve, even the bastards who are never, ever going to vote for you. Unless you believe that maybe, just maybe, this time will be different. Ha! Was it? Buggery. We came third. The Lib Dems made some big song and dance about the new PFI hospital that hadn't been finished anywhere near on time or on budget. First new hospital in the region for decades, mind. But that didn't matter by then. I did well not to lose my bloody deposit. So, I came home. Worked for the union locally, set up the charity part-time, and chaired my local branch. And when darling Mike announced he was retiring, it didn't occur to me to go for it. It was only when the boss and him had a word that I even considered it. The kids were just about old enough, John was supportive, and with Mike in my corner and the union sponsoring me, I could clinch the selection. And I did. Brownite or Blairite? That's all anybody wanted to know when I first came to Parliament. Not the Tories. They didn't give a shit. My own party. I tried to make a joke of it once and told someone I was Marmite. I don't think they got it. But eventually you have to join someone's gang. Most of the MPs I know only joined their so-called faction so they'd have someone to talk to when they were waiting in the lobby to vote. I kept my head down, voted with the whip, and tried to serve my constituency well. So I got tagged a Blairite, because that's the way the wind was blowing in those days. The crash hit Hollingsdean hard. Lots of job losses. And though the jobs came back, they're not the same. We're insecure now, but we're almost used to it. Secure in our insecurity, scared that what comes next will be even worse. The Tories have chipped away at the people of Hollingsdean for so long, they don't even notice it happening anymore. It just feels like how things are. And though that used to just be true of the factories, Hollingsdean used to be the centre of They used to say, if you don't know where you're going, you get your directions from Hollingsdean. But now, they're coming for the academics and other people who work at the universities. They're taking away the security, the pensions, the wages. So we fight for them like we fought for the factories. But look how that ended up. All those skilled workers, they're packing your shopping up at the warehouses now, and if they do come out and vote, they're not going to vote for middle-class wankers like us. Stop the cuts! Support the education workers! Stop the cuts! Support the education workers! Stop the cuts! Support the education workers! Ultimately, that's the art of politics. And leafleting. You make it harder for them to refuse. To just take one and go on their way. That's why those posh Tory wankers are so bloody good at it. They make you feel lucky for any attention they give you. Whereas me, I'm clearly just grateful if you'll hold on to it long enough to read the headline before throwing it in the bin. What difference does it make? Damned if I know. But still, we'll persevere.
Stop the cuts! Support the education workers! Stop the cuts!
Support the education workers!
No signs!
Alright, Jim. I've just been out leafleting the high street. How's it going so far?
It's pretty slow, to be honest. Not many cuts in the picket line. Not enough folk here to make a fuss about it if they do.
No, it's bloody freezing. If only mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun, it's only the British Union man, and woman, of course, will go on the picket line in this weather.
Yeah, well, why do we always end up going on strike in the bloody winter? If the Union had any bloody nous, the time the pay negotiations to reach finger pitch in the summer, then we could have all the people we want. We could make it a family fun day, like the Union used to organise back in the 70s and 80s. Do you remember that?
Folks used to take me along to those. They had everything. Music, food, games for the kids, and empty political education marquee and a full beer tent.
We should have combined them, really. Pints and politics for the people.
Yeah. I could do with a pint right now, to be honest. Or just a nip of brandy, for the sake of warming up, obviously.
Your wish is my command. You know it's not personal, right? It's just the politics of the thing, the principle. I've always believed in mandatory reselection, no matter who the MP is. I like you, you know that, but the members, they need a voice, a say.
How can you say it's not personal when it's my whole life? You trigger me, I lose the selection, I lose everything.
Yeah, but that's why this system is such a mess. If we always did this for everyone, then it wouldn't feel like we're targeting you. Which, to be honest, feels pretty shitty for me too.
Oh, does it now?
Oh, come on, Solomon, so what would you have me do? We can't not have the option to reselect. I mean, there are plenty worse than you who should be going. You just happen to live where I do.
Yeah. I understand the principle, obviously. And as long as we've got MPs who are voting more with the Tories than with us, or who are known bloody perverts, then of course the members need a say. But if the language of priorities is the religion of socialism, aren't there more important things we should be fighting right now than each other?
The priorities are fine, unless the things you care about are always bottom of the list. It's never ever the right time to give members more voice, it seems. I just wish it wasn't seen as a fight. Just a process. A chance to positively reaffirm our commitment to each other.
Well, it will be a fight, Jim. Because I will fight it.
Yes, I know. But for now, let's fight this fight while we're on the same side.
Stop the cuts!
Support the education workers!
Stop the cuts!
Stop the cuts!
Support the education workers!
join you?
Of course, sir.
Yeah, I just popped in for a quick one. I was hoping to see Jeff, but he's not here. God, it's bloody freezing out there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did the whole day. Sal showed up for a couple of hours. Not many folk around, but you've got to put in the effort, haven't you? Oh yes, I forgot. You're not on side with the unions, are you?
Well, if you mean I don't blindly support any strike anyone's ever been on ever, then no, I'm not.
It's not like we wanted to go on a strike, Sam, but the university's been bloody ridiculous. I'm a good few years of retiring, yeah, and I've got a decent pot built up, but those young people coming up behind me, the kids just starting out in academia, they're being absolutely screwed. The pensions they're being offered aren't with beams, the contracts insecure as hell, and wages are dropping. And the hours leave no bloody time for research, which is what we're supposed to be known for. It's so short-sighted.
Sorry, Jim, but my mum cleans that bloody university for 30 years? In part, so I could eventually pay a bloody fortune to attend it. She didn't get a starting salary of 30 grand or a fucking pension. In fact, she ended up not being employed directly by the uni. I don't remember her getting this much support.
No, well, we were shit when it came to the auxiliary workers. I mean, their union made good noises, but when they didn't come out on strike, our hands were tied. We could only come out in support of a non-existent action.
But go on, you could have made a lot more pressure. Just letting the uni know you would have done, you know, making some noise, instead of keeping your heads down so they wouldn't come for you. Oh, which of course they have done now anyway.
Yeah, well, yes, I agree with you, Saf. But I said so at the time that I was outvoted. Ah, but now this is the problem, isn't it? We've atomised everything, even solidarity. We only use the unions for our own case and self-interest, not in the wider interests of workplace and society. And then here we are. You and me, two members of the Labour Party, arguing over supporting a running strike.
No, I think, while we're kind of disagreeing on the process, we might be in rather more danger than we expected of agreeing on the course. Don't let my progress mates know, for God's sake.
Yeah, likewise. I'd lose my chair of the momentum branch in a heartbeat, just drinking with a blare on it like you. Hey, you don't think we've been spotted?
I think I'll see this
way. Mr. Popular. She's abstained. She's fucking abstained.
What? What, Sally?
Yeah, education bill, second reading. She's fucking abstained. She was whipped to vote against, and she's bloody abstained. Oh, fuck biscuits.
But it's obviously going to pass. The fuck is she playing at? She never breaks the bloody whip, no matter how mental the leadership gets. To do some of this, that's...
Well, I mean, that's it. That, I will not be able to stop my lot now. That's all the reason they need it. She's going to be triggered.
You almost sound like you don't want this, Jim. I thought you were on form.
No, well, I am. Yeah, really, I mean, fundamentally. Yeah, I think the members deserve this chance. Otherwise, we're just fodder there to deliver the leaflets and stand behind the candidates in photo ops. But I just wish it were more systematic.
How do you mean?
Well, she's going to see this as a personal attack, and a lot of the arguments made against her will be attacking her record, especially after this.
This is going to be so bloody. I mean, say what you like. You can't just take the human feelings out of it. I mean, Sally is going to get hurt. Either way.
Yeah, and yes, but it shouldn't have to be this way. If we just did this every time for every MP, it wouldn't be personal. It would be a process. No, I'm sorry, no, process matters. It shapes us, it shapes our thinking. It's what stops us from feeling like powerless goons. Well, like fodder.
Fodder?
Yeah, all right. Like canvassing. We knock on people's doors, for free, mind, in all weathers. We think we do it because we care about policy and politics, and when did we ever bloody talk about any of that? We just ask, hey, what did you vote for last time? What are you going to vote for next time?
Yeah.
We don't even train the members to listen correctly so they come back thinking whatever they want to think. It's so bloody pointless, I don't even know why we do it. It's like we're part of some big conspiracy, making us act like robotic automatons to break our spirit. Although, to be fair, the Labour Party will never be organised enough to carry off a thing like that.
Yeah, the thing is, though, Sammy is going to see this as a conspiracy.
yeah, but she will, but it was just a reaffirmation. She wouldn't have to. And let's face it, if we did this for every seat, 99% of them would stay just that. A way for the members to reiterate their faith in their MP. We are a collectivist party. They are there to be a representation of that collective. If we have the chance to reaffirm that, it will be much, much easier to reaffirm our collective values.
Okay, I can see that as a good argument for a rule changer conference. This, however, is not that. And we both know under the process we already have, hardly anyone will get triggered. But if you not have your way, she'll have to re-stand for the seat, beg her own party for her own job. That's humiliating for her.
Well,
never mind. Deeply unhappy when it comes to the journey.
It's inevitable now. It is going to happen. Oh, there's Jeff. Right. Right, I'm going to leave you here evening. Nice to see you, sir.
Hey.
Deliberately not taking a stand while every single of them knew why? How many of them believed that I would vote against the final bill? I was just trying to save something in committee. Not that the leadership would let me. They wanted to trigger me. I was the perfect foil for their experiment in member-led democracy. As long as it's led by the right members.
The rules on the trigger ballot, as set out in the 2019 Labour Party rulebook, Chapter 5, Clause 4, Section 5B, are as follows. If two-thirds or more of party branches, if one-third or more of party branches, or one-third or more of affiliated branches indicate they wish a selection to take place, a selection shall proceed. The MP shall be included in the shortlist of candidates from whom the selection shall be made. Where neither one-third or more of party branches nor one-third or more of affiliated branches indicate they wish a selection to take place, the MP will, subject to NEC endorsement, be selected as a CLP's prospective parliamentary candidate. So, if three or more wards in Hollingsdean, or three or more of the socialist societies and unions choose to trigger, we will move immediately to a full shortlisting and selection process.
You support the principle, Pat, but I have done nothing but work for you and the other lecturers at the uni. I've been out there in all weathers, so I'm asking you for your support now. Let me keep the energy for the fight that really matters, for your fight.
I like Sally too, Sam. I do. Yeah, I'll probably be voting for her come the selection, but that is the point, isn't it? Yeah? I'll be voting for her. Telling her again that we want her, not just drifting along as ever.
I know you're a teacher, Amal, and I agree about most of the bill. If you'd just let me explain. Amal? Amal?
It's not a sexism thing, Alex, I swear. We're not targeting Sally, she just happens to be our MP. I'd ask this of Jeremy if I lived in this unit to the north, and he'd be the first to support me in doing so.
Kelly, your support means the world to me.
Oh, you're a diamond as ever, Jack. I knew we could count on you. I know you like Sally, Safia. And I know you and I haven't always seen eye to eye, but I am asking you not to make this personal. This is about Sally, and it certainly isn't about me. This is about the Labour Party in Hollingsdean. We need a chance to talk about our own future, and this is the only way we get to do that.
But why can't we have a talk about our future without it descending into a factional shit show, Jim? Why do we ever get a say when it comes to one woman's career? Where's my say on the important stuff?
No, I get it, Sam. But the more we institutionalise choice, the more choice we have. I thought you Blairites were all about choice.
You're always calling me a bloody Blairite, Jim. I was 13 in 1997, okay? I'm no more about Tony Blair than Carol bloody Wilson, okay? Yes, I'm on the right of the party, and no, that does not make me a bloody Tory. This is about pragmatism. Why pick this fight now? When everything's already so bloody hellish.
Because now is when we have.
Hey, Sam. I hope I can count on you. We've been through a lot together, you and I. I remember when you were a new member, stuffing envelopes for me in your mum's front room.
My misspent youth.
That would be a good reason for me to vote against you, Sam.
of the socialist societies have opted for a trigger. No surprise there.
The unions were too afraid to put their heads above the parapets, so it's all down to the branches now. I know we've got the support in Winchcliffe and Somerton. We've got the numbers there.
Upton Market are a shoo-in for a trigger, as is my own ward of Hollingsdean Central. Right, strap in, folks. Here we go.
Surprise, surprise, that's Momentum Central, that is.
That was Sally's ward. They were never going to trigger her.
Yes.
Well, well, well. Just where we all weren't looking.
The bastards! After everything I've done for them.
Hold on.
Thanks, Saf. I owe you one.
So, the recount in Cassidy.
And for your support in Ambletown. We bloody nearly faced this thing down.
I didn't want there to be a trigger sound. Didn't want it to happen like this.
Well, here we are. Now, we just have to make sure that I win. So, they're going to announce the shortlist at the NEC panel meeting tomorrow. I hope there won't be any drama. Just me and some no-mark and some parachuted in Corbinite. Ha! Do you remember when we were accused of doing that by their lot? Wankers.
Sal, I don't think...
I've drawn up a list of potential supporters across the CLP. It's not going to be easy with the education bill fresh in their minds. But hopefully the manufacturing lot will come out for me and the lecturers who actually remember what I've been doing during the strike.
No, really.
And
Sal, I think...
I've drawn up a rota for phone back. Will you host one at yours, or will you just come along to mine?
You see, that's what I've been trying to tell you. I will be hosting phone banks. But for me, I hope. I've put my name forward. I'm going to hopefully be that no mark.
But, sir.
Yeah.
I know,
it's a shock. We both knew I always wanted this. I know, you would have preferred if I inherited it gracefully when the time came. One more term. I'm not keen on, I can't keep waiting for one more term.
But you voted not to trigger.
I did! And if they hadn't forced my hand, I would have been quite glad. But they did. One of five, they got one anyway. But now that that's the case, I feel I owe it to myself to put my name forward.
But I gave you a job. I gave you a start. This is what I get.
You taught me to be ambitious. And you were right. You taught me to take nothing for granted too, Sal. This is targeted. So I have to take this chance for me. I think I would be a good MP. This is my only chance to make that case. Here in the town where I grew up. I deserve the opportunity as much as anyone else does.
I just can't believe it.
Andy, you simply cannot run Clive Walker here. The man is a disaster. Yeah, I know he's on the NEC. I know he's been loyal to the leadership, but that isn't enough to make him a good candidate, and you know it. If you didn't know it, then we wouldn't be having this conversation. No, 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 I'm not frightened he'll lose. No, I'm frightened he'll win. I mean, quite apart from the fact he's thick as mince, the man has a court case waiting to happen, and you know it. If he doesn't get done by knocking seven shades out of his missus, he's going to get caught in accusations of sexual harassment. I mean, honestly, do you know a young woman he hasn't tried to feel up? I don't know why I do. If this were a Blairite, you'd be fighting tooth and nail to stop a candidate like that. Oh, yes, I know. Yes, we have. Several times. We can't accept it from one of our lot. No. We run a candidate like that, we turn the left into a laughing stock. We look like we value loyalty over talent and our principles, and that is not the left I subscribe to, Andy, and it didn't used to be yours either. Yeah, I know you're under siege. I know, yes, I know. We're all still angry about what happened in 2016 and the bloody chicken coup. We've every right to be working with those bastards that tried to destroy Jeremy, but that... That doesn't mean we get to take it out on the bloody voters. We impose Walker on the Hollingsteen shortlist, they won't thank us. Yes, of course I'm not a left candidate. You know I do, even though I like Sally. But you can't put Walker in. I'll do anything to stop that, Andy. Yeah, you know what? I'd run myself to stop him if I had to. Andy, oh, fuck biscuits.
NEC candidate shortlisting panel meeting. The NEC panel, three NEC members, considered a long list of four candidates who'd applied to be shortlisted to be the official Labour candidate for the seat of Hollingsteen. The sitting MP, Sally Finch, was automatically included on the list. She was joined by local candidates, sociology lecturer Jim Marr, and PR company owner, Safia Peters. The final candidate, sitting NEC member Clive Walker, withdrew his candidacy at the last minute, saying that the seat should be given the choice of local candidates. What wasn't officially reported in the minutes was that this only happened after Clive had his arm significantly twisted by other left members of the NEC, who made it clear to him that they didn't support him. His words, "Okay, I'll stand somewhere, anywhere else," were widely reported on Twitter. Yeah. How does Labour List get such accurate verbatim reports?
Thank you.
at my discretion. I call upon Jim Marr to address the meeting.
Comrades, I am standing as chair of a local branch of Momentum and a long-term member of the CLP.
Bloody trot!
Comrades, I will have quiet. Jim, continue.
I'm not standing as the Momentum candidate. There is no Momentum candidate. And I have no animus against our current MP. Sally has done well overall, and I bear her no ill will. But Labour has become a new type of party in the last few years. And we have to move with the times and accept and work with that. And it is the working with that that I want to talk about. The leadership changed because it came to better represent what our membership truly wants. If selected, I want to work with the leadership of the Labour Party to build a policy platform that will truly and radically transform Britain and, in doing so, Hollingsteed. I want to see our country leading in the renationalisation of key industries, and for that to benefit us all by taking the decisions and profits out of the hands of shareholders and into democratic control. Now, some think that is a backwards-looking vision, but I say we could do with a vision that looks at where abandoning the principle of public ownership has got us. The 40-year experiment with Thatcherism at the expense of the poorest and most vulnerable is over, comrades. I want to see a world where it doesn't cost a young person to have an inquiring mind, where you are not penalised for being poor, with bad housing and worse prospects. A world where we champion socialism unafraid and unashamed and are ready to fight for what we believe in rather than blunder into pointless and illegal wars. A world where greed is not the oil that turns the cogs of the machine that grinds the will of the poor. Let us come together and decide what comes next. I look forward to playing my part in whatever that is.
Here, but I want to do it with a Labour government too. A And that's why I get so frustrated with unrealistic offers and promises. It's not because I don't want to live in that world, but it's because I cannot see a way from here to there which cuts a clear and pragmatic path with an offer that excites the country, not just ourselves. I am not, in spite of the catcalls, a Blairite.
Rubbish!
I am a Hollingsdenite. That will be my legacy, and it is one I beg you for the opportunity to keep on building. Thank you.
And finally, Safia Peter.
Friends and comrades, as many of you know, I have long been a friend and admirer of Sally's. She has been my mentor and my guide for years, many years. So choosing to stand against her today was one of the most difficult decisions I've ever made. I could have glossed over that. I could have offered you platitudes, or perhaps a lofty speech, as Jim so eloquently did. But I want to offer you something real. I love Sally, and I think she's done a good job. But I think I can do a better one. Not often you hear women say things like that, is it? They can do better than others. Or if we do, we couch it up in so much soft language in the hope you won't notice what we're saying. So let me be completely clear. I can do a better job. Now that's not to say that I think Sally is deficient. Although, I do think time and bloody awful run of parliaments have left her jaded and not a little tired. But I know that the skills I have to offer from my years of running a successful business give me an edge my colleagues don't have. My background, being educated in Hollingsdean at all levels, give me a grounding in this town my colleagues don't have. During this selection process, I have been called ambitious as a slur. Here's the thing. Damn right I'm ambitious. Proudly so. This working class girl from Hollingsdean is going places. Places my mum, who cleans up at the uni after people like Jim for years, could only dream of. I am ambitious for me. But I'm ambitious for more than just me. I'm ambitious for every little boy and girl that go to the schools I went to. I'm ambitious for every shopkeeper, whoever sold me sweets or fruit and meat and veg. I'm ambitious for a better life for all of us. I'm ambitious for Hollingsdean and what it could and what it should be. Hollingsdean used to set the world on the right course. Our navigation systems set the world straight. Somehow, though, we have lost our way. But I'm going to put us back where we belong. Back on that map, back where we belong. Thank you.
Eliminated candidate.
around you.
So comrades, come rally, and the last fight let us face. The international unites the human race. So comrades, come rally, and the last fight let us face.
I want to thank each and every one of you that voted for me, and I want to assure each and every one of you that didn't, that I will do my very best work for you. I did call Sally jaded. I may well become jaded myself. Some would argue I already have by taking on this campaign.
You have done some great things for Morning's Dean over the years. I want to take your dignity and kindness in this moment as a tribute to your character and your honour. Whatever you may think of me in this moment, I will always treasure the memory of your support. Morningstein, we have much work to do. On now to victory!
Now, as we hear the chimes of Big Ben, I can tell you that the exit poll predicts that we are in line for a Conservative majority. Conservatives are predicted to win a majority of around 80 seats, predicted to win 398 seats compared to Labour's 191. That would be the best result for the Conservatives since the third election of Margaret Thatcher in 1987. And that's the worst result for Labour in modern times. Worse, significantly worse, than their result in 1983, which has always been seen as their lowest benchmark.
Well, there you have it. Maybe I had a lucky escape. I know some MPs who lost who had to move from their constituencies because they couldn't stop staring at everyone in the street thinking, was it you? This way, I didn't really lose. I didn't lose the election, just the selection. And I already knew who hated me in the Labour Party. That's why we call it a family. We lost Hollings Dean, of course. But because we're not in the north, so we're not part of the Red Wall, you wouldn't know it from the media coverage or our place in the discussion. I say we, but the big loser here was Safia. I get to retire with dignity. Jim never really wanted it in the first place, even I knew that. But I was still pissed off as hell at him for standing against me. His speech was brilliant. He could have walked it if he'd organised. But he didn't get his vote in the room to hear it. Safia wanted it. She really wanted it, and she'll probably never get another opportunity. She was right to be ambitious. She just turned out to be really bad at it. I haven't seen her since the election. I think she's afraid of what I might say. As if I would rub salt in her wounds. Much. I've seen Jim a couple of times. I think he was surprised the first time I showed up on the picket line when it was no longer my duty as MP. But the truth is, I really do care. Oh, this coat. Maybe I'll have time to go and buy myself a new one now. I really do care. I think he knows that now. 2019 is over. And I've just come to clear out my office before the new bloke, the one who beat Saf, gets to ransack my desk. Liam Byrne will be pleased to know I haven't left a note. The Commons is